Well, that sucks. I was expecting something else and it didn't show up on the screen. Anyway, hey guys, good morning. From Looney Tunes to Futurama, animation hits the child in all of us. Did you grow up on a diet of cartoons? Most people at one time or another have had cartoons that they are fond of. When watching these cartoons, you might have thought to yourself, I can do that. The professional actors you hear doing cartoon voices make it sound easy. However, being a successful animation voiceover actor requires proper training and practice. It involves not only the skill of voice, but also developing the character as portrayed in the animation. While some people consider it to be all fun and games, a great deal of time and work goes into making your cartoon shows, and central to that process are the voice actors. Many aspiring actors are interested in how to become a voice actor for cartoons, although similar to anime voiceover jobs, cartoon voice acting is much broader in category of voice over, of course, the big investments and longer projects. I'm sorry, let's try this again. The big investments and longer projects are animation films made by companies like Disney and Pixar. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Saturday Morning Cartoons. We were off for the last 2 weeks. We needed a much needed rest and relaxation and beach and all that kind of stuff. So I like to bring my cohorts, shall I say, partners in crime, the lovely Rosemarie Rose.
Hi, everyone.
The lovely Jerome Connor. Hey,
good
guys.
Good morning.
How you doing this morning?
Real good.
Good. Hopefully we'll
glad
have
to be back.
Yeah, well, hopefully we'll get our regular audiences back in. I see they're not up yet, such as Susie and Kathy and those guys. Today's segment, of course, is on voiceover actors. We decided last week what we wanted to do, and we do that each and every week, what we want to do for the next week coming up. And it seems that the consensus was basically that let's do cartoon voice actings. And we're going to have a lot to talk about. I have a hell of a lot of clips, by the way, a lot of things that basically we won't be able to get through them all as usual. You know how these shows roll. Good morning, Cheryl. Good to see you, darling.
Hey, hey, Mark, before we get started, can I just make one little announcement here?
Uh-oh.
For those who are one of our regular viewers, when we did the Flintstones, part of the reason we did the Flintstones show was so that we could cut our show down to the 1 hour time frame because I needed to get out to go to a convention. Mm-hmm. And for our audience, I want to know why we did that show. Was I ended up being the cameraman for my friend Russ Hennigan because at the convention, he proposed to his girlfriend.
Yay.
And she said yes.
Yay.
So I just thought I'd share that with the audience and let them know that, you know, we weren't trying to shortchange you, but I had to go and do something important.
Right.
And, thank you, Mark.
And that's well warranted. I like to have my regular crew here at all times, but, you know, to take up everybody's Saturday every freaking week is not really realistic. So what we try to do is accommodate. I'd rather cancel a show or not have a show at all before, you know, I say, you know, I'm not going to have the entire crew together. So that is very okay. And I hope you guys do understand that, you know, we can't do this consistently every Saturday as much as we love to. We're not being paid for this. So if we want to go out and have fun doing other things, we will do that. Okay. Good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. Cartoon voiceover actors. A lot of voices, a lot of people familiar with. If you've imitated in your office or at a party or around your family a specific character, shall I say, everybody knows the voice of the character, the name of the character and things of that nature. But what they don't understand exactly is, who are the people that are behind those voices of our beloved characters? And today we're going to talk a little bit and show you a little bit, literally, of people who you may actually recognize, but not you. They were responsible for various voices. So this is going to be cool. Hey, Jerome, I know you're suffering a cold. I'm muting you so, you know, we don't hear you, you know, die on screen. But if, at some point, if you're trying to talk and you don't think we hear you, you may have to wave at me so I can unmute you again. On the screen, like I said, you're going to see various faces of various characters. And some include the human person behind the animated voices of some of these characters. But one thing I want to show you guys, we're going to start this off right now with some early clips, okay? We're classic cartoon enthusiasts here, and we like to talk a lot about cartoons from the 50s and 60s and 70s and sometimes even the 80s. I just want you to understand that at some point during this broadcast, you may see character voices from shows that don't come on Saturday morning. So let's start off with this right now and see how you guys like this. It is a long clip, so I'm going to be stopping it at some point and then discussing. So enjoy this for a sec.
Squatching, squatching, squatching. One more squatch and I'll give you a bath.
One more squatch. Cross the heart. Mrs. Jones, can I have my saw? I'm in an awful hurry.
Yes, surely. I'll get it for you. It's in the woodshed. Oh, Marvin, do you mind answering the front door?
Sure. Would you like to buy the remarkable Widow Jiffy potato peeler? It peels spoons, pineapples, cucumbers.
No, thanks, not today.
Here you are, Marvin. Who was at the door?
Just the peddler.
Marvin, answer the front door.
But I haven't got time. You see, Joe's in.
Marvin!
Yes, dear.
Would you like to buy the remarkable Widow Jiffy potato peeler that peels prunes, pineapple, cucumbers?
No, I told you, not today.
Need a shave. Come on, come on, let's go there. I just comb my hair now. Oh no, I pressed the wrong button again. Yeah, that's better. Mirror, mirror on the wall, I'm the fairest. Let's face it. Elroy!
Oh, Mouth. Sorry, Joy, I'll have you out of here in no time. Excuse me, someone's at the front door. Hold on.
Would you like to buy peeled spoons, pineapples, cucumbers?
Oh, how many times do I have to tell you I'm busy? Now, don't bother me.
Well, really, that's a marvelous job. You can't cut yourself.
Joe, it's almost 2:30 and you said you'd be finished.
And here is where I pause it. Let me get you up on voice here, Jerome. as you can see, pretty much. Good morning, Odie. As you can see, guys, this is pretty much what we're gonna see, and we have more footage than we can actually load into this entire show. If I were to show you everything that I've uploaded, it'd probably take us 6 hours. So, of course, we're not gonna do that. I'm gonna even try to fast forward on some certain scenes so you can see your various actors that you know and love. But as you can see, the early voice of Elmer Fudd is played by the real life salesman, obviously, who was coming to the door each and every time. And now this next segment where you see the guy who's literally doing the handicap or the carpentry work there is the voice of George Jetson. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah. So that's how this is going to roll. I'm going to try and mix some real live footage in comparison to the animation for the responsible. Like I said before, a lot of people do not recognize the faces that do the animation that they're more familiar with. Jerome, got anything to cover?
Well, the world kind of knew what Mel Blanc looked like in near the end of his life because of the American Express commercial. He had lost a lot of weight, so the people had learned who he was. And let's not kid ourselves. Mel Blanc is the greatest voiceover actor of all time.
Agreed.
Okay? Everybody in the industry admits it. I've talked to a number of voiceover actors, people like Billy West. And they say basically without Mel, they wouldn't be doing this job.
Right.
Okay. The voiceover actors I've talked with, I'm friends with a couple of people that are struggling to get into the industry. And they basically said they quite honestly had never listened to people's voices before they started doing this. And they learned things about pacing, inflection, how, and they understand now accents of regional accents and dialects. And they started listening to words and where you put the emphasis on which syllable. And voiceover actors have got a very strong ear for how we speak as a people.
Go ahead. Yes, you're absolutely right. How about you, Rose?
Well, I know that it takes a lot to do voice acting. They actually have coaches, and sometimes they have them in the studio while they're performing to help them with their performance.
Right.
There's a lot that goes into it, and I know that a lot of people don't ever really put the face to the voice. I know I never did until I was much older. I knew who Mel Blanc was because everybody seemed to know who that was. But a lot of people don't know that, like, famous people are voicing these characters. Like Scatman Crothers. I didn't know for years until after I watched The Shining that he did the voice of Hong Kong Fooey.
Well, I discovered a lot of things as well. And when I find the clip on Alan Freed, oh, Jerome, you're going to love me.
I love you already. Why wouldn't I love you more?
Dude, I have a special surprise for you that I'll show in a little bit. But let me get back to what I was saying. So, yeah, there are a lot of famous characters out there who were in live action motion pictures before they literally hire. And I think that's probably a lot with voice acting back then as opposed to voice acting now, where voice actor characters back then, 50s and 60s, I'm saying, they were already established, like you said, were already established actors on television and in motion pictures. I mean, at some point, television wasn't even around, but in motion pictures. Especially all the Bugs Bunny, which you mentioned before, Jerome, with Mel Blanc and the Bugs Bunny cartoons that came before feature at the theater, or Tom and Jerry cartoons or things of that nature. There's just so many people that people don't realize that, wait a minute, that's the guy that did the voice. I mean, just look at Dawes Butler up on the screen right now and all the characters that he's responsible for. In fact, I had no idea, or probably just forgot because of my old age, that Dawes was the voice of Captain Crunch, one of my favorite cereals.
One of the things that I wanted to bring up, because I'm a big fan of this actress, is Arlene Sarkin. You know her as the voice of Harley Quinn.
Oh, yes. Yes. Now,
she is my all-time favorite, and if I were to turn this around, you would see I have a cell of Harley Quinn hanging up on the wall.
Okay.
The funny thing is she's also, she was known for soap operas before she did Harley and a lot of other voices. And she said in an interview, she loves doing voice acting for a couple of reasons. First off, it stretches her ability to speak and so on. But she says, I can come to the studio in my fuzzy bunny slippers and hair in the curlers and nobody ever sees me.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And that's the good thing about voice acting, too, is that you don't need to go to makeup. So you basically can walk in your underwear if you want to, sit down in front of the microphone and go to work. And you could be working for 8 hours and get paid for just sitting in your microphone.
Next time you're talking to Mark Hamill, ask him about how he did the Joker.
There's
a story and a half about that.
Yeah, I was going to bring him up. I want to show you guys another clip. Oops.
Rose is frozen up and I can't hear you.
One of my guests, a very fine actor on the Flintstones, Mr. Alan Reed. Sam Rappaport, the doctor says you got to have exercise, you got to get out. So he decides to go up to the High Sierras for fishing and hiking. And he's gone for about a week, and his wife's worried about him. So she sends out a missing persons report, and the Red Cross organized a big search with helicopters and walkie-talkies on the ground. And there they are, and the man sees him at a campfire across a chasm, and he hollers, "It's all right, Mr. Rappaport, we're here, we're the Red Cross." He hollers, "Go back, go back, I already contributed at the store."
Cash, cash, I have no cash. Someone must be pilfering the royal till. Summon the royal accountant. Let's have the treasury report.
Pay no attention, my little Ochichorny. He's like Gorky says in Lower Depths, quote, "Miserable being must find more miserable being. Then he's happy," unquote.
Space Ghost! So you are friends of the mighty Space Ghost. He won't find you. And if he did, I would deal with him as easily as I will now deal with you.
And I will demonstrate to you my magical powers. Powers I have learned from the combined knowledge of the greatest sorcerers of the ages.
Reaction normal. They flopped right on their face. And now for the rapid acceleration test. When I cut this rope, what velocity!
This looks like a good place to hide, Barney. Now you go climb to the top of that cliff and see if any cops are following us. I'll start collecting some branches.
It's one of the rules in the contest I'm in. I'd suggest you get in the contest too, but you wouldn't have a chance. You're over the hill athletically. Your reflexes don't flex anymore.
Ah, there is nothing as pleasing to the grateful employee as his 2 weeks vacation. With pay. Fishing at Fond du Lac, sunrise in the Rockies, basking on the beach, dude ranching, golfing, boating, and hunting in the North Woods.
Can I fix it, boy? Listen, Buster, what I know about fixing these buggies, the fella was in here just the other day, the same model, fixed it in a jiffy. Yep, looks like all you need's the new motor. No radio, no heater, tires thin, needs paint, older model. Forget it.
Where to now, Touche? Well, ahoy! On the port, the starboard attack. Looks like you've done it again, Touche.
There's his name on the box. It's Mail. U.S. Mail. Fillmore Baird. Oh, he always forgets.
Look at that chart. It's awful. Universal toupee down, federal wig down, United Scalp Wax down.
You're my broker, Crudley. What's the outlook?
Who are you, little egg-headed cockroach? You just blew your last blow, you crummy insect. Mehitable and accuracy? Oh, this I gotta see. Come on, bug.
Nobody but me, the dastardly diamond dazzler, that is. My magnetic lodestone ring will pull that diamond right out of its setting. Says you, fluid man, my moonstone ring can control the tides.
Come on, I want the whole team in here. Okay, same starting team for the second half. Let's get out there and do some. Come on, move!
Hey, little girl. What seems to be the trouble? Haven't you ever heard of the expression, two heads are better than one? Are you kidding? We may be in showbiz, but we'll never change. How about that, Bunny? She thinks we'd change.
And guys, this is just a small example on the massive number of clips that I've discovered of just Alan Freed. And like I had showed you guys before, Alan Freed, or like I mentioned when I was muted and my mouth was just moving and nothing was coming out, Alan Freed is, in fact, let me go back here. As you can see, he is this character right here, the gentleman known as Fred Flintstone. But no one really realized that all of those other voices on other shows, Space Ghost, Frankenstein and Junior and Impossibles, there was so many different elements of animation or shows in animation that Alan Reed, who is only known as Fred Flintstone, had been a part of. And I keep wanting to say Alan Freed. Alan Freed is also another character actor that I'm gonna play. You guys will recognize his voice almost immediately. And in fact, one of my favorite live action science fiction movies, The War of the Worlds, the 1956 version of The War of the Worlds. I recognize this actor's voice, and I looked at the mouth or the head that it was coming out of, and I said, "No, that doesn't match. What the hell, man?" You know. So we'll see that later. Jerome, what you got, buddy boy?
Well, you know, you look at it, and what's interesting though is, as a kid, you don't pay attention because the voices were in different shows, so you're not putting the mindset of Fred Flintstone voice with all these other ones unless you see them in a situation such as what you've just done.
Correct.
Unless you're actually catching it every so often and there's a blatant sound, okay? This guy has a unique sound. He's a baritone voice. He's got a certain rhythm to his voice, and you can catch that. And those are the distinctive voices. People like Mel Blanc could change that. They would change their register. They would change their timing, the pentameter, the inflections, all that. This guy, there was a couple of changes. You could hear some definite changes. But on the whole, voice, and you pretty much knew who it was. But because of the nature of where they put them in the settings, which is an important part of voice acting, that you never catch it in most cases.
Yeah, Alan has a very distinctive voice as Fred Flintstone. So if you saw him in other animations that we did during this clip, if you heard the voice, but it's connected to another character, you know, he has so much of a distinctive voice that I, in fact, could pull it out as being Fred Flintstone. But in all honesty, as a child or watching those animations, that would not have been the first thing I would have thought. I say, hey, that's the voice of Fred Flintstone. Although some people may, but I was concentrating more on the show, the animation, the action that was going on, that you know, we didn't get to that. So,
and that's the important part. And that's the important part of what we don't really talk about around here is the casting of the voice.
Yes.
Okay. You've got to have the right voice to the right cartoon.
Yes.
Okay. And if you don't mix them just right, I mean, imagine if let's say you reversed Fred and Barney's voice.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Would not have worked at all because the Barney voice is a higher register.
Yes.
Okay. Fred's is a lower register. Could you imagine Barney with a lower register voice? That just would not work in the nature of cartoons.
Well, remember though, Jerome, there were two Barney Rubbles.
Okay? Yes.
There were two Barney Rubbles voices, and one was at a deeper tone.
Right.
Was but, a not higher as
deep,
voice.
But not as deep as Fred's.
It wasn't the original deep. Yes, not as deep as Fred, but it wasn't the original. In fact, it was Mel Blanc who was the first Barney Rubble.
Oh, absolutely. But what you have to look here is with voiceover acting is you do a lot of cliche voices. Okay. The big guy has a deeper voice. The wimpier guy has a higher voice. You deal with a lot of cliches that a lot of people kind of don't like, but except in animation.
Yes. Yes. And I think you have to be, you know, as talented as acting is, where they say, show me all kinds of emotions, you know, show me fear, show me anger, show me sorrow, show me sad, you know, whatever. It's the same practice. For lack of a better word, for practice way of controlling your voice into various tones and rhythms and whatever to create a character. You can't just talk the same voiceover for every animation that you are hired for. In fact, you wouldn't be hired to do that. That's why I think Mel Blanc was just basically the king. I mean, this guy could break into anything almost a female. And there will be a clip if I can get to it. In fact, I want to play a little more of this clip. You guys may actually see me fast forward into this video because it's so long, but I'm trying to track something down. Hang with me. Please watch a little bit more of this one and see what we can find out.
Know ye, by all these presents, His Majesty the King, protector of the realm and sovereign of all its subjects, hereby summons you to the Grand Salon in the Royal Palace on the 8th hour of the evening of the 12th day of the 5th month of the current year. Hurry, Cinderella, hurry, hurry before the couch turns.
Stand by, guys. I made a boo-boo here. Extend your feet. I was still on the Alan Reed. My apologies. I was actually playing the wrong one.
Now, would have been finished a long time ago. Marvin hadn't been so clumsy.
Now, Joe, look here. That's no way to talk about me.
Now, listen, you two. Stop that arguing and get this mess out of my living room. They'll be here any minute.
Okay.
I'll be right with you, gentlemen, as soon as I finish with that customer over there.
Sure, sure. Take your time.
$598, $599, $600. Congratulations. With the 600th monthly payment, the pop-up toaster is yours.
Thanks. May I have my collateral back now?
Certainly. Bring Mr. Slade's collateral. He just made his final payment.
Come in.
How do you do?
Are you the masseur?
No, I'm just carrying this folding table in case I run into three people who want to play bridge.
All right. You need any help?
No, you just take off your robe.
Okay. Here you are, Don. Hold this for me. Sure. There we are.
There we are. And now... Now we can... Say, have you ever been in Tarzan Pictures?
Tarzan Pictures? No.
Oh, that's right. It was Maureen O'Sullivan. You just get on the table. No. I don't want you to lie down yet. I want to work on your neck. Just sit down over here. You and a tennis?
We'll make some nice pop pie, too.
Say, I'd hate to sit next to you at a tennis match. There you are, Mr. Slade.
Hi, children.
Who's that man, sis? I think it's Daddy.
Let's go home, children. Mama will make some nice pop-up toast for you. Hello, all you happy people. You know what? I'm the hero. McGee.
Hi, Wimp. Hey, I didn't know you were a chemist.
I guess I won't be anymore. I was messing around here just now with some stuff, and look what happened. No hands.
Ah.
Isn't that silly?
I could play these on and on and on, and I'm trying to find all. Welcome back, Rose, by the way. I'm still trying to find some of the most best scripts, and in fact, here is a prime example of my excitement. The character actor that you see on the screen on the right, who in fact is the voice of Droopy, and we all hopefully all know who Droopy was. He was in fact a classic cartoon character. If you look at this guy, you would think that Droopy was a created voice. If this guy, which I have no idea if he is or not, if he is in fact recreating the droopy voice to portray this character, and we lost Rose again. I'm going to be dumbfounded because, but here is my amazement, and I'm going to show you guys once I find it. This guy who has the voice of Droopy, I found another black and white old-timey character actor who I thought that voice was the voice of a woman until I saw him in real life. And I'm like, this is a guy. And not only that, the guy I think is a teenager. So I'll try to dig that one up. Jerome, any comments?
No, I'm just being a dad for a second here.
No problem.
Something cute. Gwen, you can go get your iPad. Okay, sorry. I mean, the question is back in the old days of the 1940s and the 1950s, some of these actors would try out these voices in what they would call the B films. Okay, this is before television. You would have the A-list films, you know, the Casablancas, the Gone with the Wind. And then you would have the B films, which were basically the shoestring, what we would call the Corman films today. And actors would basically work in those to basically, and they would try out different voices and different styles in there because they felt that, you know, really it's not going to impact the show. Okay. And as you can see here, this is a B film. And they're trying this out to see how well this is going to work. And that's what you got going on here right now.
Right.
Listen to how he's speaking. The whole idea of the way he's speaking is with the slow and all that is the cliche of a guy who's not really all there. Okay? He's not, right. He's slow. He's got a sad voice. He's a little droopy. You know, it's a cliche voice. It's not a stereotype, stuff that we don't like about now, but we accept in the cartoons. There you go, Mr. Frosted Flakes.
He's great.
Right, exactly. And notice the droopy character voice and this actor, the way he just portrayed himself. Betrayed himself is not, oh, I've lost my hands. Well, and his hands are really just hidden by the sleeves. Okay, the voice, you're immediately thinking this guy is not very smart. Same with Droopy. And what happens? Droopy comes along and shows us something completely different, which is part of the cartoon's strength. Okay?
Excellent. Okay. I want to show you. I want to keep going. I'm going to go ahead and show you guys this next clip. And this is of a well-known actress that we all know and love. So please enjoy this. I may have already tipped it off by saying actress because we all know the famous actresses, voice actors out there. So look at this.
Rocky is an all-American Boy Scout. And Natasha's a Balkan spy. We won't say Russian spy. You know, that's...
Chintry at the time.
Yeah, it still is. Yeah.
Hi, glad to see you, dear. We did some great things on the show today. Well, you ought to know, Boo-Winkle. You're in some of them.
Hokey smoke, Boo-Winkle! Well, at least no one was hurt.
Singing chipmunks? They may be useful after all. Take care of them, Eva.
I'm surprised to see you again, my pretties. Did you enjoy your visit to the castle?
I'm sorry to announce that a cheesy monster has scared away all my workers. So until we get to the bottom of this, there will be no more Scooby snacks.
Why must your horse go with you? After all, you ate the peas.
Wilma, when are we going shopping? That's right. He's going to practice spear fishing in the pool.
Oh, dear. And I had my heart set on picking up some nice, fresh lettuce.
Dear Mom, me went to Rock Valley.
Vegas for Lion's Son. Meet me there. Love, Casey. Oh, dear. Hope the soup doesn't get cold.
Why, that speck is as small as the head of a pin. A person on that? There never has been.
Stop that, you ruffian!
Oh, my word, Heathcliff is acting mighty peculiar. Auditions at Stella Studios. I'd better go with him to see that nobody takes advantage of the poor little innocent thing.
You crossed my turf. I'm gonna have to take off your leash.
Maybe I should start taking karate lessons.
Oh, Heathcliff. You'd risk your life for little old me?
Santa Claus, why? Why are you taking our Christmas tree? Why?
Children, back to your seats. The snow can wait. I've hired Professor Inkle, the magician. To entertain at today's class Christmas party.
Oh, no. Oh, you.
Oh, me.
Frosty?
Yeah, Frosty it is. Frosty the Snowman.
Yay!
I would wish for plague, pestilence, and famine.
Well, for years, the good neighbor witch has been soiled by one woman. For years, she's written stories of which witches are evil, ugly things. They're always blooms in the air. I speak, of course, of Mother Goose.
Now, I had to stop this. Hold on, Jerome. And I see she popped back up. This can go on forever to ever. I'm going to keep prefacing this, that I have freaking hours of this stuff. But
you know, Mark, you need to, we got to get you a life.
Hey, look, all I did was look at the counter to see how long the freaking clip was. Okay. I didn't watch it all, you know, but this is just an example of the most famous, I think, of the female animators. And hold on. Rose, I'm bringing you back up. Oops, I missed you again. Hold on, I'm bringing you back up, dear. The most famous of the female animators, or let's just not classify any gender whatsoever as if it matters, but she's the most famous of the voice actors in cartoon history, and that is June Foray. And if you looked at those number of clips from various shows, from the Smurfs all the way down to Bullwinkle, you can see her range. She not only did the voices of women, but she also did the voices of boys, of men as well. And she was just fabulous, because just listening, and I like to concentrate on very, very minute things when I'm listening to anything, especially music. You can tell that just by listening to her voice that she is in fact acting. She's acting. It's not reading a script. She's literally showing inflection and anger and all kinds of hemispheres of her brain being used to utilize what she's trying to convey to the audience. It's just absolutely phenomenal. Hello, Rose. Welcome back, dear.
Hi. I'm sorry. I'm having like major problems over here on this end today.
What's our motto, Jerome? What's our motto?
It ain't a show without a tech glitch.
Thank you very much. You were just acting normal.
you know, I think you need to put that in our opening card. It ain't a show without a tech glitch.
Yeah, I think I will add that for our next show. Not next week, because I'll be in. In fact, a little commercial here. I will be bringing Saturday cartoons.
Saturday
morning cartoons to the Great Philadelphia Comic Con next Saturday morning, live. I'll try to probably Facebook Live it, but I'm going to be in front of an audience as I'm showing stuff on the screen and awakening hopefully the new generation to what we grew up with and basically enjoy. And the good thing about it, I'm going to say this. I know you love this first, Deanna. I'm sorry. It's just the blue thing. They creep me out, okay? All those boys in one chair. Anyway, so I'll be in Philadelphia doing this show, and I'm hoping that a new generation can see what we grew up with, what we love, and we still went outside and played because we did not have electronic devices to play on. Well, go ahead.
Yeah. So back to our voice actress.
Please.
There's a history of actresses doing young boy voices. Okay. There's a long history of it. The most famous of it is that underachiever, Bart Simpson, is done by Nancy Cartwright.
Right.
Now, one of the things that surprised me as a child, they did an interview, was during the 1970s, there was a lot of Charlie Brown specials from movies, holidays, and all that. And I found out that just about all the Charlie Brown's voices were done by a girl. Now, as a little boy, that's kind of devastating because I always identified with Charlie Brown. But, you know, but
well,
that's,
it's funny you say that because this is a test. We can't see our audience's hands right now. But do me a favor, everyone raise their freaking hands when they remember their voice changing. Okay, so I no longer Jerome spoke like a girl and was damn proud of it. Thank you very much. So go ahead. <please. laughs>
Now it's but there's a long history of it. Because of the nature of the young boy voice being at a higher register than that. You know, you talked about knowing when your voice changed. Mine changed sometime between sixth and eighth grade. I went from being in the alto section of the choir into the baritones.
Thank God you didn't you were about to scare me there for a minute.
But I had a high voice. I had a very high voice. I had a high singing voice. And then as I got, you know, in closer into the teenage years, my voice did drop. It was not like everybody, you know, like you see in the Brady Bunch where the voice cracked and it dropped. Mine went over a period of time.
Well, it does take time. I think it does. Separated it for Brady Bunch.
Yeah. So the female actresses don't get the press. I hate to say that, with the exception of a few of them, they don't get the press that the male actors do, and that's definitely a shame. And I think we should definitely let the world know about these.
And
great
I agree
actresses.
With you 100%. They don't get the press, but it's not like we don't recognize their contribution to animation.
Yardley.
Right. Yeah, that's Yardley.
I love Yardley.
You need to be specific on that only because Bullwinkle, or Rocky, shall I say, of the Rocky and Bullwinkle show, had a very, very prevalent voice, and June was responsible for that. And let's try to keep going here. I want to put this point up that Garrett made. Garrett said, it's so amazing the voice actors that shaped our lives. And he's right. Not only did we imitate, okay, characters' voices, shall I say. Not only did we imitate character voices, but we actually portrayed them in a physical aspect. And here's a prime example. When the Flintstones run, okay, it's their legs and feet moving, but the arms are always straight down to the side. Okay, who the hell runs like that? But we went out and we imitated it anyway.
We all tried it and we found it didn't work.
Yeah, it didn't work, but still, it was a remembrance. Okay, and I'm sure these actors, this is what their intention was to the audience, was that they remember what it is that they brought.
All right, so you got a picture of Yogi. You had a picture of Yogi up. Okay. And how many people go at work and you go, I'm smarter than the average bear.
Smarter than the average bear. Hey,
boo-boo.
You know what?
Exactly. And that's the voice actor. The writer came up with the words, but the voice actor put that tone in there that we all are making fun of right now.
And no one talks like that.
Exactly.
Hey, I'm smarter than the average bear. I talk like this every day. There's no one that can say, hey, Fred, what are you doing, Fred? How are you doing? You know, no. You know anybody, Rose, that laughs like Betty?
Not really.
You know, it makes us all look doofus, okay? But we enjoy it. Enjoy it. Okay, I got to find this clip. Talk, Jerome, while I pull this up, please.
You've got a picture there of Yardley Smith, and Yardley is I've always been a fan of, and there was a show back in the 90s on Fox called Herman's Head. Yes!
I loved it.
I fell in love with Yardley on that show.
That was a great show. Everybody hates that show, but I liked it. I was one of the, like, 10 people who liked that show.
I remember that show, too, and it's funny that how we look at what's our character in the Simpsons? What's wrong with me?
Lisa.
how we look at Lisa, and it's like, you know, you pick it with Yarley, and you say, well, wait a minute, that's the voice of Lisa?
Oh, yeah.
The same with
the first season, by the way. Rose, I felt the first season was the strongest. And by the way, what was the animated, the Pixar show, a movie where they inside the little girl's head?
Oh, boy.
Oh, my God. And I saw it and loved it.
Lewis Black was angry.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, but Herman's
inside
head.
Inside Out.
Thank
Herman's
you.
Head, Inside Out. You can't tell me there wasn't influence there.
There had to be.
Absolutely. Okay, I'm dropping this. I'm muting you, Jerome, mainly because this is a surprise for you. All right, so this next clip, you guys are going to enjoy. Please enjoy this.
It's the most amazing thing. We were doing some promos for the Bennett special coming up yesterday, and one of the interviewers said, did you ever do voiceovers? And I said, yeah, I've done some. He says, did you ever do anything for Hanna-Barbera? I said, yes. He said, did you do the Flintstones? I mean, yes. Were you the voice of the Great Gazoo? Yes. Now, the interesting thing about, I was only about 13 of those episodes that had the Great Gazoo in it, and it was an enormously popular character. As a matter of fact, some years back, I traveled for Hanna-Barbera. They had these huge conventions and seminars where collectors collect cells. And the cells with the Great Gazoo on it are worth lots of money. And I never realized how, you know, I still get the little guy and people are, you know, collectors, you know, on eBay and stuff, and they want my autograph. And it was a very popular character, the Great Gazoo. I just made him sort of, you know, dum-dum, you know, very, you know, superior and arrogant and elite. I didn't know what to do. I'm really not a very good voiceover actor. That's a special, special talent these people have. Like the people on The Simpsons are so brilliant. And they can, you know, most of them, there's only six actors and they do about 50 characters. So I'm not quite in that league. When I first started doing The Flintstones, Joe Barbera would be directing them. Hannah was more, you know, on the creative side and drawing and stuff like that. Wonderful guys. I would like to get the script beforehand because I don't like to ad lib. I mean, not ad lib, but I like to be prepared. I make notes for myself about where I'd like to go, where the accents shall be, where the transitions are, and I my script looks like I don't know what I have different colors for different symbols that only I understand. And then when I get there, then I adjust. I adjust to what the director wants. I adjust to what the other actors are doing so that I can, you know, interact with them. But I like to prepare for those. And I'm kind of self-conscious about it because I know it's not my milieu. As I feel self-conscious in front of a camera, I'm not really a good movie actor, I don't think. I got away with one or two that I was pretty good in, but I'm very intimidated by the camera. I always feel like I can't really be who I am, and I try to be more or less. When I'm on stage, I feel much more comfortable. And especially as a sketch actor, I can be larger than life and get away with it because that's what's expected. But always the element of truth underneath.
What do you guys think of that?
That's great. I'm glad you found that.
That is fabulous.
As soon as I came across it, I went, ooh, 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 ooh.
You know, and he is almost certainly risking his Oscar. You know?
Well, you know, it's funny, though, because Harvey Korman, even before, this was before his presence on the Carol Burnett Show, but yet we know of his, let's say, Emmy-winning performances from Carol Burnett. But when he did Gazoo, I don't think I've ever seen him in anything before. I could be totally wrong, but back during that time, it was, you know, hey, I need work. I'll do voice acting. Today, Okay, today people are actors, shall I say, well-known actors would kill to be the voice of whatever is coming out, whether it's on television or motion pictures. Go ahead, Jerome.
All right. So in the mid '90s, you had a lot of A-list actors starting to do a lot of voiceover work, especially in the Disney films and the Pixar films. And they managed to drag one of these actors in for an interview on this question and ask, why are you doing this? Now, we talked about Arlene Sorkin talking about, you know, nobody has to go through makeup. The other one says, I want to do something my kids can watch.
Yes, or remember before. Yes, yes.
And then they found they liked it. Okay, they enjoyed the voiceover work. And that's why you saw some of these actors that were A-list actors are now shifting further and further over into voiceover because they find they enjoy the work more than standing in front of the camera. They find that standing in front of the microphone is much more challenging to them. Okay. And they like doing that because that's what they got into it. They got into it to be challenged as an actor. And when you look like Tom Cruise, you get Tom Cruise roles. But if Tom Cruise does voiceover work, he can change his voice and he can be any character. I'm using him as an example. I don't know if he's ever done any voiceover work as my disclaimer here. But the point is you're not typecast as a voiceover actor. And that's why these actors are doing this. Now you're seeing a whole mess. There are people who do just voiceover work.
Hey,
my favorite character on a Cartoon Network show called Total Drama Island is Chris McClain. The actor does nothing but voiceover work.
Agreed. Yeah. You know? Now, in comparison to what you're just saying, here's the actress right here who plays the voice of Bart Simpson. I don't recall ever seeing her in anything after I realized that she was the voice of Bart Simpson. It's like, well, where else have I seen her, or have I seen her anywhere since? She could have been. I'm slowly recalling maybe like an episode of Friends or something like that where she played a live – I'm muting you for a sec, Jerome – where she played a live-action role on Friends. I know I did see her live action, but I didn't see her anything before that. Like I have mentioned before, guys, I'm moving along here. There is, in fact, a individual whose voice does not match the face. Okay, I mean, even if you never heard, you would. That's the whole point of this show. You would have heard his voice, but then when you see him in real life, you're like, whoa, 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 whoa! Who the hell is that? Well, I'm about this first scene that I'm going to show you guys right now. This first scene is, in fact, when you are going to remember, oh, yeah. And then it will continue with his cartoon roles as well. And of course, I can't play it in its entirety, so you're going to see a large portion of it. So bear with me. Watch this because I really want to see some faces right now.
The target for the A-bomb is this nest of Martian machines in the Puente Hills, where more of these meteor cylinders came down early last evening. All radio is dead, which means that these tape recordings I'm making are for the sake of future history, if any.
Who the hell is that?
This is Ben. Can you hear me, fella? Reed, I'm calling you. Tell us what to do and we'll do it. Don't give up, pal. Something awful is happening to me. I can't stand it. I've turned into some kind of thing. You won't find him here. He turned the ray on himself and is now back on your world. Farewell, Fantastic Four. We shall never forget you.
Correct. I am not a car. I am the Night Automated Roving Robot, the first in a bold new experiment. You may call me Car.
Get in.
Let me show you what I can really do. You need me. I meant what I said earlier. You may not be Aladdin, but I am the genie. I can make all your dreams come true.
the air is deathly still. That is the time when ghosts are present.
There's no
turning. This is so cool!
Our tour begins here in this gallery, where you see paintings of some of our guests as they appeared in their corruptible mortal state.
Because you'd be a stranger to their ways. Nobody down there really wants to know Jack Frost. Give me time to consider your request. A century or two, you may become human. Temporarily, I will give you a winter of humanity.
Dami, dami on my knee, who is handsome as can be? And dummy, who is brave and strong and nice? He's slipping again. Fun, huh, dummy? Hey, who is that girl? Ooh, she is beautiful. I will woo her and win her for my wife.
What does your majesty wish of me? Schmendrick, my dear boy, how nice to see you. The legendary Schmendrick? The runeless wonder? I realize your majesty is a great collector of oddities, but...
You bet I do. Come in here and close that door, Rubble. Too late for the coffee break again this morning, eh, Rubble? I've been looking for you all morning. Sit down. Not on the floor, dumbbell. In the chair.
Friends, that baby in a tree item reported earlier proved to be a hoax. The baby turned out to be a little brontosaurus dressed up as a child.
Now I will prove that whoever controls the elements controls the universe. There is only one threat to my plan. Space Ghost. But I will soon eliminate him with my ice ray. Soon all on Earth shall know my star band surpasses any power in the universe. We meet again, Green Lantern.
I will have my revenge on the Guardians themselves.
Let me introduce myself. I'm Professor Ludwig von Dyke. Today we are going to discuss the wonderful world of color. This whole program is being seen in color. And that's a lie. You know that's a lie. Because only the people with color TV sets is seeing it in color.
Don't tell me. I'm going to tell you. That's Mr. Billy, isn't that you? Willie? Lily? Bisbee?
Bisbee. B-I-S-N-E-Y.
Gotcha! What do you think you're doing with my dishes? Jiminy, I got no use for fish mooch and bait. Come and get it, little fishes. Jump for your dinner, Hortense. That's a good girl.
Hey, Jose, Hitsu. Don't tell me you forgot your old pal Manuel Tijuana Guadalajara Tampico Gomez Jr. Now, what brings you to my humble little country, of which I am sheriff? Si, Jose. And I, Manuel Tijuana Guadalajara Tampico Gomez Jr., will assist you.
Elga Bambu, at your service. He comes and goes at will. He is a wizard, you know.
One that I is gray and ordinary.
Herr Bürgermeister, Herr Bürgermeister, look what was discovered on your front stoop. No, sir, a baby. Please, sir, take care of my child and protect him from the dangers of the mountain of the whispering winds.
A toy? As I suspected, I hate toys. And toys hate me. Either they are going or I am going. And I am certainly not going, Clint.
Right now, you're probably asking yourself, how do people quench thirst at the beach?
Hey, I'm going to stop this and I'm going to go back to the beginning so you guys can now again or once again see the face of this guy who started all of this, okay? So the voice of this character, this is 1956 version of War of the Worlds, and this is the face that goes with the voice.
Four of these meteor cylinders came down early last evening.
all radio is dead. Which means that these tape recordings I'm making are for the sake of future history. If any.
Reed, this is Ben. Can you hear
so
me?
I think this guy went all the way up into Alan Freeze, of course, no relation to Alan Reed, with different spelling, of course. His career went all the way up into the 80s, probably even further, but you can see where he got his beginnings from. His much-loved TV shit series that we all watched as growing up, from Rudolph to Santa Claus Is Coming to Town to yada, yada, yada. So that was, in fact, Alan Freeze, guys. Go ahead, Jerome.
All right. First off, we lost Alan Freeze in 86.
Okay.
I just checked him. Good. Alan Freeze, he does my favorite character in the Santa Claus Is Coming to Town. I love the Burgermeister Meister Burger.
Yes.
He does that voice, and he, again, we have a distinctive voice here, okay? And without a doubt, you cannot visualize. When I heard the voice, I knew immediately the Burgermeister. To me, immediately. And that's the key with voice actors. You hear that voice. I don't have to watch that show anymore. You just play the sound clips, and I'm running the movie in my head because of how those voice actors are.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's what they're trying to do. For all intents and purposes, voice acting is radio acting.
Yes.
Okay, and the voice has to portray the action.
Yes.
You can have horrible, horrible animation. And we have seen some of it, as we have discussed in earlier shows, which we talked about, like the Captain America and Iron Man and all that. Horrible, horrible animation. But you get a great voice actor, it all doesn't matter, because that voice actor is going to make you believe that that person is real.
Absolutely. And the thing with these voice actors, you made a good point. They did come out during the radio era, okay, and before the invention of television, when more houses had television in here, these voice actors had to, or the radio actors, shall I say, had to make a decision in order to keep their careers going. They had to adapt to the technology that was coming forward at that time, which was television. So it was only natural that a lot of the, and it's the same go between the transition between silent film, okay, and Rose is back. Between silent films and, of course, the talkies, as they called it back then, that these silent film actors sounded horrible when they spoke. Okay, so there was only a percentage, it could have been a large percentage, of these silent film actors who could actually transgress into the talkie, avalanche that was coming their way. So, yes, so that was Alan Freeze. Hello again, Rose. Welcome back.
Thank
Hi,
you.
Rose.
And as usual, guys, each and every week, and I told you this at the beginning, I have more freaking information that the time will allow. We are already past our hour on the show, but I need to really show you guys probably the top two voice actors of all time that everyone basically knows. So let me gear this up. Hey, guys that are joining us, thank you, guys. I know it's at 10 o'clock, and you guys probably have to start running and doing your errands and all that kind of stuff. We're going to go a little bit longer here. I have some really interesting stuff I'd like to show you guys. But as in every single one of our shows, it's always a one-hour show that we can never do in 1 hour.
We did it once. We did it once.
Barely, Jerome. We had to cut ourselves short.
Yeah, we had to cut ourselves short. But it was for your benefit, and I was cool with that, too. It got me to the grocery store earlier. So I hope you guys that are watching, Susie's not with us this morning. I wonder where Susie is, but nonetheless, hope you guys are enjoying it. I'm going to show you guys another clip. This is probably one of the most famous, character actors, voice actors, shall I say, of all time. You will recognize his voice, not necessarily his face, but that's the point. You're supposed to be listening to him in the first place. So we did Alan Freeze, who's a very recognizable voice. Here's the next one. Let's make sure the volume is on. Yes, it is, Mr. Mark. And let's go.
I've been working for them ever since they started their own company 25 years ago.
And you do Scooby-Doo?
Yeah, I'm Scooby-Doo. Well, I started as a ventriloquist, so you see, that's how that all came about.
Learning to talk without too much action.
And let's have the microphone talk. Hello?
Hello? Hello? I've never got an ear.
Okay.
I missed you. Yeah, a restaurant.
There goes a natural-born criminal type, if I ever saw one. Me, Sheriff. Bing, bing, bing. Ricochet rabbit. Come back here, you masquerading rabbit.
Of course this is Snip. Who else would be answering Snip's phone? But I gotta finish that Moscow order. Not to mention Alaska, Mount Fuji, and January Junction. All right, you'll have them, you'll have them.
Sorry, we've already got an alligator in the zoo, and believe me, one is enough. He's right over there. That's Wally, our alligator.
In a manner of speaking, Johnny, it can help map the recent wave of unexplained thunderstorms by detecting unusual electrical discharges like lightning.
It might not be a bad idea. I hear it's the land of opportunity. It's hard to squeeze out a good living that way. You deserve better. I want you to work smarter, not harder, lad.
Good evening, folks. I'm Ranger Smith of Jellystone Park, and welcome to the Yogi Bear Surprise Birthday Party.
I haven't seen Yogi all week, Cindy. Have you? It's too bad Yogi's working so hard for nothing.
It's big out here. Are you my mother? Then I want to be like you.
It's the right way if you're a dyed in the wool scaredy cat.
Party?
There's a rip, bing, bing, boom, bing, 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 pitcher. I'll get it. No, I will rip, bing, bing.
It was my pleasure, Monsieur Coulet. Your dessert, Monsieur. Strawberry mousse pie.
The entire universe will bend to the power of Moltar. Now to throw the launching switch.
Titanor can counter any of Space Ghost's forces. Good. I will issue a challenge.
Yes? What's all the excitement about? Now, my little Smurfs, I'm sure there's nothing to worry about. He's probably still out smurfing for you.
They're called dinosaurs, lad. And this one's just a baby. Dinosaurs haven't existed on Earth for 60 million years.
Look! Trolls! Please, don't leave us!
I have not forgotten the arrow that brought me down so many years ago. I have not forgotten the wizard who found me and healed my wound.
What's up, Dixie? Don't tell me the mad scientist is cooking up something in his lab.
Yeah, let's keep it a secret this time, Jinx.
So that be a unicorn. She is very beautiful. No cat out of its first fur can ever be deceived by appearances, unlike human beings who seems to enjoy it.
You robbed me! You robbed me! You robbed me!
Okay, creeps, there's gonna be some changes around here. Who's gonna pay to see Rudolph the Unlit Reindeer with the very nothing nose?
You're a couple of thousand miles off course, almighty wizard. Uh-oh. Why not admit it, oh great wizard? You're lost.
Peace.
But, Aunt, I wasn't able to find honey. Honey! I've been looking for you a long time, honey.
You must be referring to the fact that Friday was originally known as Freya Day, after the Norse goddess of love.
Let's put Snow White on video.
How about another theme park?
Genius, Jeff.
No. Okay, so that was, of course, Don Messick, and that is one of the most well-known voices in animation history. Jerome, you have anything to add to that?
You know, ironically, nobody really... Huh?
What, Rose?
I don't see Jerome at all.
Oh, we see you.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's you, Rose, but no problem. We see Jerome. And you hear him, right? Oh, you don't hear Jerome either?
No. Oh, can you hear me, Mark?
Yes, you're fine, Jerome. I think it's Rose's connection. So you may have to do it again, Rose. That's okay. That's okay. We can hear you, Rose. But go ahead, Jerome.
Don Messick, ironically, is not as famous as some of the others, even though he has done some of the most famous voices there is. He did Boo Boo. He did Scooby. That alone is a career.
Yep.
Okay. There are millions of actors out there that would love to be identified with a few characters like these. These are iconic characters. And what does he do? He goes on and does more and more. And he's like Mel because you can hear he doesn't have basically the same type of voice. He does a variety of different ones. His range is great. And that's why Don was around. Sadly, unfortunately, we lost Don back in 1996.
Okay.
But look at the voices and the stuff he has done. You could not tell me that Dr. Benton and Boo Boo were the same voice. Okay? And that's the best actors there are.
That was true acting. Like I said before, these guys are professionals at what they do. And I could have gone on. That was only half of the clip, which we don't have time for. But I basically wanted to bring one of the two character actors that are as well known as some of the others, if not more. I have one more to show you. Rose, did you have any comment on what we can? Everyone online is saying they can see and hear all of us. So it's your connection, Rose, but we can't. So stay on. Don't go off. But if you guys have any comments, or do you have any comments on what you just saw from Don Messick?
I never knew he did Papa Smurf's voice. That's news to me. But I always loved Muttley's laugh. That was, really great.
Yeah, and he did what's his name? I guess it's Chi-Chi from Space Ghost. He did the freaking monkey, which was almost like a balloon whistle or something like that. And it's like
he did the cat.
He's amazing range. He had amazing range.
Yes, he did Hong Kong Fooey's cat. And he did say he was a ventriloquist before, but that doesn't practice you in making that sort of range of different kinds of sounds, not just going up and down with it, but literally going outside of speech and doing things of that nature. It's just unbelievable. Okay, here is the next, and like I said, I could have kept going with Don Messick. Here we got another show that we need to maybe do a part two on, but here's another character, actor, shall I say, that you guys are gonna recognize his voice almost immediately. So enjoy this, and we'll come back and we'll be on for at least another 5 minutes. Just enjoy what you're watching so far, guys. Here's the next one.
Well, that's close. No, Doss Butler is mine. My name is Huckleberry Hound.
What?
Huckleberry Hound.
What's my name?
And I also, I'm a bear.
I'm Yogi Bear.
Oh. And I'm a cat. Mr. Jinx is the name, and I like to chase those miserable mises, you know.
Yep. Just the right setting for the nutritious breakfast you need. Right. It's gone. You can't get away with the crunch, because the crunch always gives you away. Aha!
By the way, cat, just what is a family gradenza? I'll tell you this, it's not in the unabridged dictionary, but let's find that thing and get rid of that cat.
If Robin Hood were but alive today to help the poor woodland creatures from the hunter's gun, etc., etc. Heavens to Murgatroyd! Exit merry as ever! Stage left!
Correction, monsieur. I am not the auto mechanic. I am Loopy the Loop, the wolf. I, Loopy, do not think like other wolves. I am considerate, charming, helpful.
Oh, pleasure, Mary Poppins.
You're our favorite person.
Millicent!
Now all we need is a big old fat pumpkin. What a pity. What a pity. It's the cruelest mean I've ever heard of.
Super banana!
Oh, that's good. I haven't slept for 4 nights. She put me to sleep. Mildred, put me to sleep.
But, Dad, you're not going to break your word, are you?
Well, he can take you for healthy horseback rides, Flabby Dad. Can't you, Roscoe?
Are you hurt? Tall in the saddle, Dad?
Ladies, thanks for the basket. Don't worry, I won't turn you in. They were two of the cutest little old ladies you ever saw, Boo. I guess they, just like bears. Maybe so, Boo-Boo. But I don't think it does a thing for me. Yay!
Oh, Pappy, we've chicken hawks. Why can't we have chicken?
Because there just ain't no chickens around here. That's why. Have some black-eyed peas, Elvis.
But they don't even look like black-eyed peas, Pappy.
Take another look, boy.
But I want to stay in business. How can I do it? Spend his profit on machinery? When does it all end? By thunder, if that's the way it's done, I'll do it.
Esta hora de famosa, muy plenty stinko borracho.
I'm sore now, so I'm gonna have to use my patented, never fail, hippo, hurricane, holler. Oh, gee, doctor. I mean, don't feel so bad. With your talent, you can do big things.
My. Welcome to the land of expectations. We certainly don't get many travelers these days. Now, what can I do for you? I'm the weatherman.
I must have your names before you can proceed.
Okay, guys. Like I said, hours and hours and hours of this stuff that you can watch. And I just want to show the next famous actor, of course, was Dawes Butler. We saw Don Messick. If you guys don't remember Casey Kasem, who played Shaggy, also a big voice back during that time as well. And those are, I honestly think that there is a museum of probably the 10 top voice actors of that era. There are, in fact, lists online of the top 50. IMDb has a great list of the top
50. I don't like that IMDb list.
Yeah, the IMDb list is really strange, and that's why I didn't really pull it out.
They concentrate on the more modern voice actors. I took a look at this before the show.
Yes.
And they concentrate on basically the modern era. They don't go back at all to any of the classics except for Mel.
Which is what this show is based on. This show is basically for classic cartoons. And I like to keep that staple, although I said at the beginning, there are going to be some things I'm going to be showing you guys that has nothing to do with not only classic cartoons, but cartoons in general. Like we saw, you know, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, and of course, that was stop motion animation, so it probably does classify in the animation segment there, era there. But we're more classic, unlike what you see here, okay, which is Castanello, or forget his name.
Dan Castanello?
Yeah, Dan who played Homer, and as opposed to this, which is Wilma and Fred from classic era Flintstones, early late 50s. And of course, here is Messick himself. And then, of course, you have the true cast of the Flintstones, which on the far right is Mel Blanc. I guess that's my right. I hope you guys are seeing right on your screen with his head leaning on Alan Reed, I'm sorry, who portrayed Fred Flintstone. Mel Blanc is the guy who portrayed Bonnie Rubble, but he already had established his career with Bugs Bunny and Yosemite Sam and all kinds of different characters back in that era. And it, as you can see, a list of characters here. Let me put this on the
screen. Well, all right, let's take Dawes for a second here. Okay,
let's do that.
To this day, I do some of the phraseology that I've heard. The snagglepuss part, okay? Exiting stage left.
Stage right,
I mean, come on, how many times have you not said that in your, at least in your head?
I love snagglepuss.
Whoa, you know, hold on. Not really. This is why I love classic cartoons. Let me get us all up on the screen here. This is why I love classic cartoons, because it educates us. Remember the opera that was in all the Bugs Bunny movie and turned people on to opera? I had no idea what exit stage right meant, which in fact is a theater term.
It is.
No,
I learned that in the drama club in the seventh grade.
I'm sorry, I was born on Earth. But anyway, there's no way I could have known exit stage right. Yes, you did, because you practiced the trade, basically.
Okay, so Mark, yes, now sir? When you're at Philadelphia next week and you're on the stage, you're gonna go. Exit stage left, laughing all the way.
Yeah. And let's see how many people get that. You know, since I'm bringing the
cartoon. How many of the actors are going to get it?
Well, I'm sure the actors are going to get it. All of them are going to get it. Or shame on them. But you're right in terms of Dawes and what was that? Was that Snagglepuss?
That was Snagglepuss. Yes. Now, how many times have we sung, My Darling Clementine in the Huckleberry Hound voice?
Hey, let me tell you something. I knew My Darling Clementine from Huckleberry Hound when I was young, and then I got heavily into Westerns, especially black and white Westerns, and there is a movie starring Henry Fonda and
called My Darling Clementine.
My Darling Clementine.
And that's the gunfight at the Old Gate Corral.
And I'm like, oh my God, Snagglepuss is singing the theme song.
Huckleberry Hound.
Huckleberry Hound is singing the theme song. I'm like, what the hell, man? So cartoons back in those days educated people like us. Our generation. Okay.
Again, with Dawes. Dawes.
It Huckleberry was culture Hound. For them when the shows were created.
What was that, Rose?
It was like pulp culture. A lot of their stuff was like timely for their time. And then we saw it later. And so we got educated on their pulp culture.
And this is how we don't forget the culture, by continually repeating it or latching on to something that we enjoyed hearing. And we're repeating it throughout our entire childhood or generationalhood. And then the current generation, like, what are you doing? And it's like, what? You've never heard of. And that's why I'm so
Or
no longer exist on television.
I'm going to use a wide brush here, but you say to a millennial, better watch out for that picnic basket. They don't know the reference. They've heard it and they sort of get it, but they don't know the reference.
I don't even think they know Yogi Bear anymore. Okay.
I think they catch it every so often.
Well, out of sight, out of mind. And if you don't necessarily see it enough times to relate to it, you're not going to repeat it constantly and currently like we, our generation, do in common everyday conversation.
Oh, no. You ask a millennial about being smarter than the average bear, they know the line. They just don't know where it came from.
I think only because that is more of the most common term used rather than exit stage right. I think smarter than the average bear is pretty much of a defense against somebody being called stupid. You know, say, well, what's wrong with you? What are you talking about? I'm smarter than the average bear. Now, where did that come from? You know, and that's what I hate about our current generation. It's like everything is going by the wayside and we cannot forget. We have to constantly say these things to our kids. So number one, they ask questions. Then number two, because of the power of technology, we can show them. And then number three, they go, hey, that's pretty cool. I want to see another one. And then
Exactly.
And that's how you continue the trend by constantly showing things to people that they didn't have when they were growing up. This childhood, this generation does not have anything to show. You're sure they have animation. But they're not running downstairs at 8 o'clock in the morning, bellying up to the television set and waiting for their next episode of their favorite TV show.
What they are missing, and this is not a slam on them because this is a slam on the people running the stuff, is they are missing a shared social cultural event.
Yes.
Okay. We all shared, because of the three networks and because of the Saturday morning cartoons, we all shared that event. It was a shared cultural event. And that's what's missing right now.
But look how far we can go back. I wasn't born in the 40s. I wasn't born in the 40s, but yet I know Bugs Bunny. I know, you know, words from Daffy Duck, you know.
But that stuff was shown on the Saturday morning cartoons.
Rerun. Exactly. Right. Rerun. Okay. And we are lost with reruns. We don't have reruns to point out to our children, this is what I watched when I was your age. You got to watch this. This is so freaking cool.
Exactly. You
know? This daddy is trying. It's hard, but I'm trying. Well,
you know what? And parents, and for good reason, okay, parents don't point out anime to their children. Children learn anime on their own. The parents don't say, look, I watched this when I was growing up. Okay, and nowadays it's more things that the anime has gotten a lot more risque in some of its, you know, productions, and there's a lot of reasons why parents do not want to share some of the anime these days with the young kids, because you have to sit and watch it with them just to be prepared to turn that sucker off if it ventures into, you know what, you know, the sex arenas and things of that nature. I can sit my child in front of the violence of a Tom and Jerry cartoon and still feel that they're going to be okay walking out that door. They're not going to go in and drop a refrigerator on somebody's head when they're walking along the sidewalk, you know, and I'm okay with that. But I miss a lot of the things. And this is what this program is about, is basically bringing people back up to speed on things they may have forgotten. Okay. And that's the nature of our show. This can go on to a part two, guys. But
it may, you know, it may do that.
We held our viewers with us as long as we possibly can, and I appreciate those that stayed with us, the Sheilas and the Deannas and the Sages and the Odies and the Kevin.
Can I just say one thing, Mark?
You can say anything you want, darling. Go for it.
I that's what I want to say. What I want to say is to bring you back to what you're doing next week. I've seen your live productions with regard to Saturday morning cartoons at conventions.
Oh, okay.
And I think they're incredible. And I think that you're educating, going out there, you're educating a whole new audience to classic cartoons.
And if you want to call it a service, that's all well and fine. It is just ultimately a passion of my own that, you know, you ever want to sit a kid next to you on a couch and go, ooh, watch this scene, watch this scene. That's how I am constantly about classic cartoons. It's like, you've got to watch this. It is so freaking cool. You're not going to believe it.
But in doing that, you're educating a whole new generation when the parents are there and they bring those kids to those conventions. And sometimes they might have never seen Huckleberry Hound or Yogi Bear.
Right. And with the power of YouTube, thank God for YouTube, that hopefully when they walk out of one of my panels, they can say, hey, I want to see more of Peter Potamus. You know, what the hell's Peter Potamus? What? Are you kidding? Dad, you should have seen it. It was a hippo and a freaking balloon, you know, hot air balloon traveling the world, you know.
Or Johnny Quest.
And Johnny, don't get me started. Don't get me started. Stop, breathe. Be still my heart. I'm not gay, but I love the movie or the show. To educate folks. I got my friends Garrett and Deanna and Sage who do Hanging with the Web show. And they bring awareness to people who have skills that we don't have, and they make the audiences aware of, hey, look who's around. You guys did not know this, but this person does this. This person has been there. This person has starred there. And I feel the same. Even though when I'm on stage with an actor, is pretty much putting their talents on display. With me, I'm putting cartoons on display, the cartoons that I grew up with on display that, like you said, Rose, that I want generations before me, way before me, to see and enjoy and to know that, yes, this is not computer generated stuff, guys. Hand drawn, cell by cell, scene by scene. It may take 100 drawings to constitute 1 second of animation, but can you imagine the skill? Okay, and the obedience to doing something like that just for the sake of entertaining us, man. I respect those kind of people. All righty, we're going to go on final words for Jerome and for Rose. And then as I lead you guys out, I'm going to play, I guess this is Dawes stuff I still have up on the screen. I'm going to finish off with showing a little bit of Dawes stuff before we finally tune out, just to leave you guys with a little bit of animation. As you turn me off. Let's go with Rose. Rose, any final words about voice actors, cartoon voice actors that we did today?
I just think we have a great bunch of people that are going, you know.
I got you, babe.
I lost my train of thought. I'm so sorry. Everybody have a great weekend. It's been a crazy day for me.
That's okay. That's why you're a great writer. I can't write, so okay. Jerome, go for it, dude.
Without the voice actors, we wouldn't have the Saturday morning cartoons. We wouldn't have the shows running in our heads right now with everything going on. We wouldn't have what is basically culture as we know it because of what they do. These are the voices of generations. These are the voices of our friends. And these are the voices that have influenced us to do things. And it's just a cartoon, but they influenced who we became. And without them, who knows what we would have become? We would have become our parents. So thank you to the voice actors and to the current batch of voice actors. Keep doing the good work that you're doing.
I wanted to be a plumber because I think butt cracks are so funny. Ha, 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 ha. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys so much for joining us. We lost Rose, but that's okay. Rose, you'll pop in to do our post-show meeting. Cheryl, thank you so much for your kind words on the screen there. I'm going to go ahead and end this with more animation from Dawes Butler for you guys to watch. And then I'll show a little bit of that, maybe a few seconds or maybe a minute or two. And then we'll go ahead and say goodbye until next. I'll try to live feed this next week, okay, for my show in Philly, the Great Philadelphia Comic Con. If you guys don't know, I'm moderating a bunch of panels. I'm definitely going to be moderating Anson Mount. If you are not a Star Trek Discovery fan, last episode was just a mind blower, which kind of keys into me sitting with him next week in Philly. But there is an episode Thursday night before the show that's going to wrap up, I think, Anson Mount's final appearance on Discovery. No spoiler, but that episode was fantastic. I was shocked to know that those occurred because I didn't think that they were smart enough to actually include Gene Roddenberry's vision into everything, and they, in fact, did. And I'm so happy about that. So I'm going to look forward to Anson. I have Nana Visitor, Michael Dorn, and Jeffrey Coombs, part of Deep Space Nine cast that I'll be moderating. I'll be moderating five cast members from The Expanse, which is one of my favorite sci-fi shows that are on currently. If you did not see or hear that, I'm moderating a couple other people. Edward James Olmos and Hogan.
Battlestar.
Battlestar Galactica. Yeah, I'll be sitting with them again. I'm going to tell a story about Hogan and how I saved him from a bar fight in Germany. Okay, that's going to be a tree story. I'm going to try and live stream some of my panels from Philadelphia Comic Con next weekend as well. There's a couple other people I'm moderating panels for. I can't remember, but I know there are a lot of more other guest actors that other moderators will be taking care of. So,
I wish I was going. Great show. It sounds like a great show.
No, it's good. Like I said, I'll try to live stream as much as I possibly can and legally can. You'll be with me next week. My cartoon show, I'll try to figure out how to run that. I'm going to take my tripod so I can have my camera up. Actually, I don't need that. Anyway, that's something else I need to work out. I wish all my good friends, Deanna and Garrett and Sage, were going, but they are at UltraCon next weekend. Guys, this is our passion. This is what we do. This is Saturday Morning Cartoons, and we focus on the classics, at least all the way up into the 80s, maybe early 80s. This is our passion. We love enjoying this each and every week. We'll let you guys know what the show is going to be focused on the week after next weekend. We're going to talk about that shortly with my crew here. But in the meantime, where is my... Oh, wait. Oh, the video's on the screen. I'm so stupid. Hey, guys, talk to you soon. Thank you for joining us. And then please look at a little bit more of voice acting by the great Dawes Butler here.
If you'll just tell me when you were born, where you were born, why you were born, how old you are, how old you were then, what grade you're in.
Welcome to you, your faithful dog, and that handsome gentleman. I'm so terribly happy to see all of you.
And what have we here? Ah, I see. Breakfast.
Yes,
an idea. If there's one thing I can't swallow, it's an idea.
We'll carry it, huh, Scooby-Doo? Okay, into the machine. One, two, and a Scooby-Doo.
Well, there you are, son. When I promises to take you on a picnic, I takes you on a picnic, right? That's my boy.
Now there is a dumb dog. Excuse me.
Oh, it's been a bad day, Ding, my friend. We found no food for our empty stomachs. We might as well go home. Could be trouble up ahead. One of those game wardens. Good day, sir. What is this notice I notice?
Okay, Morton. We got enough chow for a week. Well, we better get going. Hey, Morton. Why don't we just get rid of the cat?
Oh, yeah, Ralph. Why don't we just get rid of the cat?
Oh, I oughta...
Just set it down where I can reach it.
Did my spearfishing outfit scare you? Hiya, Fred.
And what are you made up for?
I'm gonna practice spearfishing.
Oh, you can't lose. You'll either spear them or they'll die laughing.
Now you've done it. Down, 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 darn yarn. Something very magic about this ball of yarn. Between you and me, I think the Wicked Wazir is a wizard.
As the official judge, I unanimously declare that the winner of the first prize is Sweepy for his strongman float.
Well, I hope Old Spacely has decided to merge with Cogswell's Cosmic Cogs, because if he don't, this place will wind up selling space cycles.
Only a couple, Mom. See, I'm trying to invent some tablets that'll make you fly. Gee, maybe I should cut down on the uranium mixture.
Whoa! Whoa there! Whoa! Easy does it!
Sometimes it just won't pay me no mind.
No.